President Masoud Pezeshkian issued a stark warning. If excessive water use isn't brought under control, our dams will run dry by September. Fatema, a 26-year-old living in Tehran, shares that she orders expensive water online just to take a shower, and she manages to do it with only 2 bottles of water. Tehran now faces 12-hour water cuts. In the capital, water has become a rationed and penalized resource. The government declared a nationwide official holiday for conservation. Public institutions closed down, and working hours and days were shortened. This was basically announcing crisis mode. Almost half of Iran is now officially among the provinces facing water shortages. Meteorological data shows rainfall has dropped by nearly 40% in recent years, with 19 provinces suffering severe drought. 19 of the country's largest and most strategic dams are about 80% empty. Some are down to just 0 to 15% capacity. In Hormozgan, the Shamil and Nian dams have completely dried up. At the same time, Tehran itself is literally sinking. Excessive groundwater extraction has caused parts of the city to subside by tens of centimeters each year. It's an invisible earthquake that silently threatens buildings, infrastructure, and metro lines. Actually, today's situation was predictable long ago. In the summer of 2021, large-scale protests erupted for access to water. People were chanting slogans like water, electricity, life, our inalienable rights. This was the turning point where the justice for water debate was embraced by the masses. So, who's to blame for this massive crisis? What did Iran do wrong? Can all this be explained just by global warming? Will the solution paths be able to save 90 million people from water scarcity? How realistic are the planned mega projects? Get ready, we're diving into a deep and long topic. Iran today is under extreme water stress, so much so that it now falls into the water-scarce country category. Annual water availability per capita is below 1,000 cubic meters, compared to a global average of 5,000 to 6,000. If Iran drops below 500 cubic meters per capita, it will be officially considered under severe water scarcity. Long-term climate data says heat waves are getting more intense and dry periods are lengthening. The picture Iran is in also threatens food security. Agricultural yields are dropping, and in some regions, farmers are abandoning their fields. According to economists, disruptions in the food supply chain could deepen inflation and poverty even more. Health risks are mounting. Diseases linked to water shortages, lack of hygiene, and poor sanitation. Experts warn this crisis could affect up to 50 million Iranians and even trigger mass migration. Now that the scale of the disaster is clear, it's time to dig into the root causes. Iran is naturally a dry, semi-arid country. Its water resources are unevenly distributed, both spatially and seasonally. The northwest is relatively wet, while the center east is quite dry. Climate change is making this uneven picture even harsher. Heat waves are intensifying. The temporal distribution of rainfall that feeds the year is getting disrupted. In 2024, while rainfall amounted to about 400 billion cubic meters, 70% of it evaporated. According to energy and environment experts, Iran's average evaporation rate is 3 times the global value. Over the past decade, summers have repeatedly broken temperature records, with many regions exceeding 50 degrees Celsius. Rising heat and declining rainfall have brought the longest droughts in modern history, 5 consecutive years of extreme dryness. The Deputy Minister of Energy reported that average rainfall in 2024 to 2025 dropped by 45% nationwide. In Hormozgan province, rainfall fell by 77%. In Sistan and Baluchistan, by 72%. Rivers like the Karun lose up to 90% of their flow in dry seasons. Lake Urmia has shrunk by 90%, creating toxic dust storms. The result? Desertification, more frequent sandstorms, and an accelerating spiral of climate-driven collapse. Iran, with its 90 million people, consumes around 100 billion cubic meters of water per year, almost double that of neighboring Turkey, despite similar population size. Over 90% of Iran's fresh water goes to agriculture, though only 12% of its land is farmed. Cities and industries share the small remainder. That balance determines the nation's water future, because irrigation methods and crop choices essentially set the country's water destiny. In Iran, inefficient methods like surface irrigation are used. Irrigation efficiency is shown to be around 30 to 40% on average, meaning more than half of every 100 units of water irrigated doesn't turn into useful crops on the field. It spreads on the soil surface, evaporates, or gets lost through drainage. This outdated method not only wastes water, but also prevents natural recharge of rivers and aquifers. Then there are deep wells and pumps. Once, Iran relied on kanats, gravity-fed underground canals, relatively sustainable, but these have been replaced by high-capacity motorized wells, which massively increased groundwater extraction. Studies show Iran is pumping out billions of cubic meters of non-renewable water each year, causing water tables to fall by tens of centimeters to over a meter annually. This has created a vicious cycle: more wells, more farming, more depletion. Crops are another problem. Despite the dry climate, Iran persists in cultivating water-intensive staples like rice, sugarcane, and alfalfa, as well as pistachios and corn in some areas. The result is catastrophic. Lake Urmia, once a vast inland sea, has dried up, choked by damming and unsustainable agriculture. What's left is a salty desert littered with chemical waste and fertilizer residue. Strong winds scatter toxic dust, harming millions in surrounding regions. In 1980, Iran's population was 35 million. Today, it's about 90 million. Urbanization has exploded, with three-quarters of Iranians now living in cities. Tehran, Isfahan, Mashhad, these megacities consume water at unsustainable levels. Analysts from the Stimson Center point out that the concentration of people on the Central Plateau has created extreme pressure on limited resources. Cities depend heavily on groundwater, causing aquifers to collapse and infrastructure to crack. This collapse isn't just about water, it's physical land subsidence. Satellite data shows large areas sinking by tens of centimeters each year. Around Tehran, some places are sinking even faster. Roads crack, railways warp, buildings are damaged, sinkholes appear. The competition between drilling, farming, and urban expansion threatens entire communities. From the 1970s onward, Iran saw dam construction as the way to solve its water problems. Today, there are more than 600 large and medium-scale dams in different regions of the country. On paper, this looks like a strong measure against drought, storing water, irrigating agriculture, generating electricity, but in practice, the picture is much more complex. Many dams were built without proper basin-level planning. Lake Urmia's collapse is a prime example. Climate change played a role, but so did the dozens of dams on its feeder rivers. Natural flows were cut off, the lake's supply dwindled, and its transformation into a salt desert accelerated. Elsewhere, interbasin water transfer projects, like diverting rivers from the Zagros Mountains to industrial cities, drained local ecosystems, deprived villagers of water, and stoked social tensions. Solving one region's water problem created another region's drought crisis. Another weakness of large dams is evaporation. In Iran's hot and dry climate, a considerable portion of water stored on the surface evaporates and is lost. Especially in summer months, massive reservoirs actually work like massive evaporation pots. So, a noteworthy part of the water you store mixes into the atmosphere before reaching the user. This shows that investments made in the name of efficiency are contradictory within themselves. But dams are only part of the story. Since the 1980s, Iran's industrial and energy policies have been just as decisive. Water wasn't only for drinking or farming, it was redirected to feed giant factories, power plants, and energy projects. From the 1980s onward, large industrial investments planned to diversify the country's economy, especially steel factories and petrochemical facilities, caused water consumption to rise unexpectedly. Steel production requires thousands of liters of water per ton. While Iran aimed to be the Middle East's largest steel producer, it built most of these factories in regions already under water stress. For example, the Mubarak steel plant in Isfahan comes up not just for its production capacity, but also for its massive water consumption. Local experts say this facility alone has a big share in the drying of the region's Zayandehrud River. Similarly, petrochemical facilities and power plants are dependent on constant and intensive water use. A significant part of Iran's electricity production comes from thermal power plants, and these plants need large amounts of water for cooling. So, to produce energy, water is drawn from agriculture or cities and directed to factories. These policies provided economic gains in the short term, but severely eroded water security in the long term. The flaw is clear. Water meant for survival was diverted to fuel-heavy industry, and most of these plants weren't equipped with modern water-saving technologies. Instead of producing the same output with less water, Iran doubled down on using more water. The result? Both aquifers and dams are running dry. So, how is it possible to make such big mistakes right in front of everyone's eyes? Analyses emphasized that some projects were done through military semi-state companies and that environmental impact assessments remained weak. Experienced environmental scientist Isa Kalantari describes the failure to take measures as ending a 7,000-year-old civilization. According to Kalantari, water policies are determined by bureaucrats and some private companies. The term water mafia thrown around is used for this budget-focused megaproject supporting network. And in Iran, water mafia isn't just a metaphor. For years, journalists, activists, and analysts have accused politically protected networks of profiting from water projects, wells, and dam contracts. This network includes major construction firms, local strongmen, military-linked conglomerates. Critics say they act in concert, hiding the ecological and social costs. Rapid commercialization of water resources plus lack of oversight creates profit opportunities. The profits come two ways. First, giant infrastructure contracts. State-backed projects hand billions to favored contractors, often with inflated costs and poor oversight. The Gotvan Dam is a prime example. Engineers warned about massive salt beds, but were ignored. The result? Millions of tons of salt leached into the reservoir, poisoning the water. Similar disasters have unfolded at Karkay and Zara dams, devastating local ecosystems. Second, subsidies. Cheap electricity and diesel make pumping groundwater profitable, allowing wells to be exploited and water sold or diverted. Estimates vary, but there may be 600,000 to 700,000 wells in Iran, many unlicensed, with widespread illegal deep drilling. This uncontrolled extraction is the backbone of the water mafia. The Revolutionary Guards IRGC are often named in these accusations. Their engineering arm, Khatam al-Anbiya, is one of Iran's biggest contractors, running major infrastructure projects. US Treasury reports and researchers alike note their central role in state contracts. Critics argue that when military-linked firms dominate water projects, competition shrinks, transparency disappears, and inequality grows. This is one reason why water mafia claims carry such weight. In Iran's water crisis, sanctions work like a power outage. They don't dry up the water source on their own, but they paralyze the system. The impact of sanctions doesn't look like war or drought, but they shrink budgets, squeeze international supply, make financing difficult, and block maintenance and repair, all of which accelerate the collapse of water infrastructure. Over the years, heavy economic sanctions severely reduced Iran's oil revenues and state income. As a result, the government's budget shrank, investment in infrastructure declined, and money for maintenance became scarce. World Bank reports show that beyond sanctions, fluctuations in oil income have also squeezed government finances and restricted public investment. This doesn't mean a brand new treatment or sewage project is canceled. It means repairs to existing facilities are postponed, pipes crack, pumps wear out, and chemical supplies are delayed. Banks and insurance companies, wary of violating sanctions, avoid dealing with Iran, access problems to international payment systems like SWIFT make project financing and importing materials extremely difficult. US sanctions on shadow banking and transaction networks deepen this bottleneck. Once payment channels close, importers can't obtain already scarce spare parts and technology. Modern treatment plants, pumps, membrane filters, or reverse osmosis systems all depend on advanced engineering and supply chains. When international suppliers avoid risk, they either don't sell at all or get stuck in long licensing processes. The result? Facilities age, efficiency drops, and breakdowns multiply. Amid this chain of disasters, Iran is also searching for solutions. In practice, the government is moving along three channels: demand restriction, agricultural reforms, and large infrastructure projects. Official targets include ambitious goals such as cutting water use in agriculture and industry by 45 billion cubic meters per year by 2032. But implementation is difficult due to high costs and political resistance. Restrictions imposed on the public are no longer symbolic. They are concrete and strict. The government has declared temporary holidays in big cities to curb water use, ordered public institutions and municipalities to remove lawns and shut down decorative fountains. And in some provinces, household water flow is cut on rotation, or pressure is reduced. In the capital, a 20% savings target was announced. And in some provinces, emergency conservation measures have been enforced. These steps make life harder and increase the risk of social unrest. Experts say simply shutting down illegal wells could reduce Iran's water consumption by nearly 20%. That's why, over the past decade, the government launched a large-scale closure campaign. Security forces and water authorities sealed thousands of wells, especially in drought-prone regions. But these closures often sparked protests from villagers and farmers, since for them, these wells were the only source of livelihood. Along with this combined approach, agricultural reforms are also being pushed forward. There are three main measures here: modernizing irrigation technologies. State loans were offered to promote drip and sprinkler systems, but the cost per hectare ranges between $1,000 to $2,000. Considering Iran has more than 8 million hectares of irrigated land, a full transformation would require over $10 billion in investment. Limiting water-intensive crops, planting rice and sugar beets, which consume a lot of water, has been banned in some regions. This decision has sparked major debate, especially in provinces like Khuzestan, which are wet but climatically sensitive. Promoting greenhouse farming. The government is supporting modern greenhouse investments that use less water. According to the Agriculture Ministry, greenhouse areas grew from 18,000 hectares to 23,000 hectares by 2023, with a goal to double that in the next decade. In theory, these measures could save 10 to 12 billion cubic meters of water annually. For Iran, this is the biggest potential source of savings. But changing farmers' habits, restructuring state subsidies, and covering the high costs require a serious struggle. Iran has long coastlines along the Persian Gulf and the Gulf of Oman. Because of this, turning seawater into drinking water through desalination has become an increasingly strategic option. Today, Iran's desalination plants are estimated to have a combined capacity of about 600,000 to 700,000 cubic meters per day. One of the largest is near Bandar Abbas, with a daily capacity of 200,000 cubic meters. The costs of these plants are enormous. For example, a modern facility with a capacity of 100,000 cubic meters per day costs around $300 to $400 million to build. Operating costs are also high. Treating each cubic meter of water requires $1 to $1.5 in energy and maintenance. By the time the water reaches inland areas, its price multiplies. A nuclear-powered desalination project in Bushehr is also on the table. Iran needs to consider desalination not just for coastal cities, but for inland regions too. But this creates a massive new challenge. How do you transport water into the desert? One of Iran's most talked about initiatives in recent years is pumping desalinated seawater to the country's center and east via massive pipelines. It's almost like carrying the sea into the desert. Phase 1, the first leg of the line, opened in 2020, carries water from the Sea of Oman to Kerman and Yazd provinces. This roughly 700-kilometer pipeline and accompanying pumping stations reportedly cost around $1.2 billion. Phase 2. Plans are in place to extend the line to Isfahan and Razavi Khorasan in coming years, with costs estimated at $2 to $3 billion. This would make the total line over 1,500 kilometers long, with costs estimated at $5 billion. The technical challenges are huge. Pumping water hundreds of kilometers inland requires massive amounts of energy. In short, Iran has chosen to pursue solutions through mega projects. These projects may ease the crisis in the short term. While desalination and massive pipelines are central to the solution, experts say this alone isn't enough. High operating costs, energy needs, and the environmental impact of brine discharge into marine ecosystems are concerns. So, the government needs to balance short-term goals, like providing urgent water to cities, with long-term needs, such as demand management, irrigation efficiency, and legal institutional reforms. Otherwise, while facilities and pipelines are completed, the question of who the water is for and at what cost will remain unresolved. Share your thoughts about this with us, and don't forget to subscribe. See you in the next video.